was my name. He knows my name. Yes, he knows my name. And oh, how he walks with me. Yes, oh, how he talks with me.
Hallelujah, Center First. Can we just stand to our feet tonight? I know we've got many distractions outside of this place, and I know we've got many things going on outside of these doors, but can we just lift up our hands and declare in this place that every praise is to our God? Come on, church, can we magnify in unity, and can we lift up our hands in submission to the King tonight and declare that we're going to give him every praise? Lord, we worship and we adore you in this place, God. We magnify and we worship that sweet and holy name. In Jesus' name, God.
Every praise is to our God. If you know him as Savior, why don't you give him praise? If you know him as a healer, why don't you lift up your voice? Oh, come on, if you know that he is a deliverer and he has set you free from the bondage of sin, then you ought to be able to praise him. Come on, I think him being a Savior is just enough for me. We can literally sing that part of the song over and over, my Savior, my healer, my deliverer, and that is enough for me to lift up my hands and to give him praise. Why? Because I ain't forgot about where I come from. Oh, come on, I ain't forgot about the hell that he's pulled me out of and how he lifted me up out of the miry clay. I haven't forgot about that blessed hope that he's leading me towards. Every praise is to my God. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, why don't we praise him one more time? If he's ever done anything good for you, you ought to be able to praise him. If you got a past that he delivered you from, you ought to be able to praise him. And if you're in the house of God tonight, just know it's by the hand of the Lord, and that's enough right there for me to worship him. This is his house. We're guests in his house, and we come to entertain him. Let the church say amen. Why don't you give him one more hand clap of praise as you make your way back to your seat tonight. We welcome you in the house of God tonight. It is good to see all of you at church. I believe I said it last weekend. Thank you for bringing the church inside of the building. We also welcome all of our guests that are here with us tonight. We hope you feel at home. And we are thankful that you chose to be with us. We also greet all of our online guests. We thank you for logging on and joining us online as well. We want to remind everyone of our offering boxes located at the back of the foyer, while also reminding you of how grateful and thankful that we are that you are a giving church. We thank you for your generous giving, and we do acknowledge your sacrifices. And again, thank you. You can also give online on our church app or online on our website and our church app. And if you don't have our church app, now would be a great time to download the church app. And while you're at it, you can download our church directory. We are in the process of trying to update our directory. And so if you are not in our church directory, please see one of the ladies out in the at the Welcome Center. Update your contact information if your number has changed, your email has changed, or your address, any of that type of information. We want to know about you. We want to have all of that information online. Just for instance, if tonight that storm would have came in a couple hours earlier and at the last minute we would have had to cancel church service, we would have sent out a mass message on the telephone, and if your name was not in the directory, you would have showed up and you would have been the only one here. And so we need all of your information in the directory so we can notify you of urgent announcements, but also in case we need to contact you just to wish you happy birthday or to wish you a great day. Please remember our youth fundraiser. Our youth is raising money for Move the Missions and for youth activities and events. We invite everyone to support our youth group by placing donations outside in the jars. If you want to see someone kiss a pig, put your money in the jar. I believe, at least I didn't check it tonight, but I know this morning old brother Aiden was ahead in our youth group, and sister Yamboree was ahead as far as our adults were concerned. And so please keep putting dollar bills in those jars. Whoever has the most money by time our epic youth event comes up, they will be the ones who will have to kiss the pig. But of course, all of our money goes to support our youth department. Also, mark your calendars for a legacy fellowship. This will be July 18th. That is a Thursday at 6 p.m. We're asking that you bring food or you can make a donation. There is a sign-up sheet outside in the foyer as well. Everything is at the welcome desk. You can always find what you need out there. Again, that's Legacy Fellowship, Thursday, July 18th at 6 p.m. Amen. You know, with the storm coming in tonight, it reminded me of a scripture that talked about how God is a shelter. And it talks about how God is a refuge and a very present help in times of trouble. And there's another scripture that talks about his name being like a strong tower that the righteous can run into and be safe. When I come to the house of God, I know this is a place where I'm safe. I know this is a place where there's refuge and there's shelter. And I remember some of my very first church services over at the old building. I came in and I had so many things going on in my life, I remember having the feeling of, I just wish I never had to leave. I remember wishing that if somehow I could stay, if somehow I could just move into a back room somewhere, if I could just stay here and I didn't have to go back out into the world, then everything would be okay. It's like when I came into the house of God, my problems seemed to disappear, even if it was just for a little while. Anybody ever felt that way? You see, I found out quickly that this was a place where the hardness of the world and the wickedness of the world just seemed to where it couldn't penetrate. It seemed like it could all be forgotten. This was where my burdens and all of my weights, everything I carried, could be lifted as soon as I walked into the sanctuary of God. You see, in God's house, there's love. In God's house, there's peace. God's house, there's joy, and joy that just takes you out of all of the pain that you're experiencing. In God's house, there's mercy and there's forgiveness. Oh, come on, church. Does anybody know and are thankful about God's house? You see, I know that when I walk in here, I can forget about everything else that's going on outside. There is just something about coming into God's house where all of the believers are gathered together. And the Bible promises us when we gather together in His name, He is there. He says, I am going to be there. I will be in the midst. And folks, when God steps in, all the problems do seem to disappear. And all the sickness does have to subside, because when God steps into the midst, everything just starts getting better. When you step into His presence, you do start feeling that love, and you do start feeling that joy, and you start feeling that peace. And all I want to do is just lift up my hands and begin to praise Him and begin to worship Him. Folks, this is a safe place. This is a refuge. This is a shelter. You're not going to have to lift your hands by yourself. You're not going to have to shed tears all by yourself. There will be somebody coming alongside of you and laying a hand on your shoulder and say, I'm going to worship with you. I'm by your side and I'm on your side. Come on, somebody. Why don't we step out tonight and just begin to worship God? Come on, you're in a safe place tonight. There's no persecution in here. There's no oppression in here. Nobody's going to make fun of you. You can come and lift up your hands, and you know what? Your burdens can be lifted and those weights can be subsided, and you can forget, even if just for a moment, all of the problems of this world. There is help in times of trouble. He is our refuge and our strength and our weaknesses, our shelter in our times of storm. Come on, why don't we just lift up our hands and begin to praise Him? Come on, why don't we worship Him together? Why don't we lift up our voices to Him together and begin to cry out to Him together? Why don't we become one body and be in one accord? Great things happen when His body gathers together and worships in one accord. The Holy Ghost will begin to fall, and the joy will begin to fall. The peace will begin to fall. Come on, folks. Let's worship Him tonight.
What the Lord has done, when I think. shine like the sun. We will call on you, God our Father. Heal our land, let it be done here on earth as it is in heaven.
Your kingdom come, your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Your kingdom come, your
and clap your hands unto the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. Amen. Why don't we lift up our hands in this house tonight and let's let the Lord just continue to speak to us right now. Come on, there is such powerful Holy Ghost that's in this house tonight. There is such a powerful presence of the Lord that is in this place tonight. Come on, did you come with a faith that says God can do anything tonight? Did you come in this house with your faith saying, God, I need something from you? Did you walk into this place with your faith declaring, God, I'm not going to leave the same way I came, but I'd expect, God, my faith is reaching out to you, God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Amen, 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 amen. Praise God, amen. One more time, would you give the Lord a great hand clap of praise? I want you to turn to somebody. I want you to tell someone next to you. I want you to tell them there is a miracle for you tonight. Would you tell somebody that? Come on, tell them there's a miracle for you tonight. Amen. I still believe God's house is a place of healing. Hallelujah. I still believe it. I still believe that this is a place where when you walk in here, the Lord can do anything your faith can reach out for. Amen. Do you believe that tonight? Amen. I want you to get with your neighbor. We're going to hasten to the word of the Lord tonight. And I tell you, I'm thankful the Lord kind of just let that storm turn into maybe just some showers that are coming in. And because I've got a word tonight, and I'm glad you're here. But I want you to get with somebody and just connect with someone. Let's go to the Lord in prayer before we get into the word of the Lord tonight. And I want you just to ask God to have his absolute way in their life. Would you do that? Would you just say, God, do whatever you want to do in their life. Come on, in Jesus' name, God, do whatever you want to do in their life, Jesus. Have your way, God. We surrender to you, God, everything. Everything, God, we give to you, that you would work in our life, God, that you would look down into that heavy heart, that broken spirit, that wounded mind, that mind full of stress and anxiety, worries and troubles, that God, you would reach down in the midst of that and you'd place your hand upon it. Oh, I feel a healing touch in the house tonight. I feel a healing touch in the house tonight. Ha, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, glory to your name, Jesus. Glory to your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you, worship team. Amen. For leading us into the presence of the Lord. Amen. I want to hasten to the word of the Lord tonight. If you have your Bible, if you'll turn with me to Matthew chapter 1, verse number 18. Matthew chapter 1, verse number 18. And I know the passage of scripture that I'll be reading from is really a passage of scripture that we often, as preachers, tend to read from during the Christmas season. And I think it'd be all right in the middle of this hot summer to bring some Christmas anyways, praise God. And so we're going to read from Matthew chapter 1, verse number 18. If you're there, say hallelujah. Amen. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on the wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream. Would you turn to your neighbor and say, God still speaks? Come on, turn to the neighbor on the other side and tell him, God still speaks. And so it was that the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. She shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. Would you say that? Jesus. For he shall save his people from their sins. Verse 21 more time in your hearing. She shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. For he shall save his people from their sins. Amen. Would you put your Bibles down and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we give you high praise in this house. We ask, God, that you would have your way, that, God, you would speak to us, God, that we would leave this place never the same again. We give you praise in Jesus' name. And everybody say, in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing. Amen. I don't know of a more exciting time in the life of a parent than when they are waiting for the arrival of a child. They're waiting for the arrival of a child. And it is with this passage of scripture that we just read and that I want to title my message tonight, What's in a Name? What's in a Name? If all of our parents are in the house tonight, you know of that excitement, and you know what it felt like when you were waiting for the moment that you would hold that child in your hands, and the excitement. We've got some here that tonight have children that have just been born just recently, and man, what an exciting time, and I'm sure they're getting lots of sleep and all of that good stuff. And then we got new grandparents in the house, and just exciting when a baby comes on the scene. It's an exciting time. And while most of the time people will come up to us and they'll ask us, when you have that baby, they'll say, is it a boy or is it a girl? Let me just pause for a moment and say, it's still the same. Well, I thought I was in a Pentecostal church. Hallelujah. It's still either a boy or a girl. Amen. And so they'll come up to you and they'll say, is it a boy or a girl? And you'll say, we're having a girl or we're having a boy. And excitement, and they're excited around that. But the next biggest question that often happens is outside of, is it a boy or a girl, is often, what is her name? What are you going to call her? What is his name? What are you going to name him? And because finding out what a gender of the child is, but without a name, it's somewhat incomplete, isn't it? Just to say we're having a boy, or just to say we're having a girl, but not having a name, it's incomplete. There's something missing there. And so parents will spend a tremendous amount of time considering what they will name their child. How many remember those days when you went back and forth with maybe your husband or wife and you swapped different names and choices? And how many have made a list? You remember the list of names, and maybe you chose a name after a grandfather or a grandmother, or a family name was placed in there, because it's important what we call our children and we consider their names. The name of the child will be what they are known by more than anything else in their life. In the Bible days, a person's name described their characteristics. It often described not only that, but it often described their circumstances. At other times, biblical names depicted a person's traits or their environment that they were in. In fact, when God told Abraham, who was 100 years old, and his wife Sarah was 90 years old, when he said to them that I am going to give you a son, and you're going to have born of you, Sarah, a son, the Bible tells us that Abraham and Sarah began to laugh. They laughed at the prospect of having a child at 100 years old and 90 years old. And when Sarah went on to give birth to a son named Isaac, she named him that because that name means laughter. Laughter. That's what Isaac means, laughter. Because it was in that circumstance that laughter came out, because they just couldn't believe that they would actually have a child. And so Isaac's name means laughter. Then Isaac and Rebecca come together, and they have two sons, twin sons. And the first of these twin boys was named Esau. How many remember that name, Esau? And Esau's name means hairy. I don't have to describe his characteristics. You get the picture. He was a hairy man, and therefore he was called Esau. And because of how hairy he was at birth. And then the second of the twins was born. And this son, when Esau was born, he reached out and he grabbed a hold of the ankles of Esau, grasping at him as an attitude or a spirit about him that says, I don't want to come behind in anything, and I'm not too excited that you're going first. And so it is told to us in the Word of God that this second son of the twins reached out and grabbed the heels of Esau. And it was that this child's name was called Jacob. And Jacob's name means that supplants, meaning that holds on to, that grabs a hold of. Jacob thereafter would go on to wrestle with God and be renamed Israel. When he got into that wrestling match with God and he held on to him, because remember, his name meant a supplanter, or another translation calls him a heel grabber. Jacob, he wouldn't let go of things that he wanted. He grabbed a hold of that angel and he said, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me. And the angel said, what is it that you want? Because the day is breaking and I've got to leave. And so it was in that time that when he wrestled with the angel, which really was God himself, that he was renamed to Israel. From Jacob, the supplanter, from Jacob, the heel grabber, he was changed into the name Israel, which means one who wrestles with God. Wrestles with God. It is here that we see that the names of people, they meant something. They were connected to situations. They were changed and transformed to talk about a new destiny or a new vision or a new future. It is now that we can see through these examples that I've given the importance of a name more so in biblical days than maybe today. And I want to bring us back to our opening story that I started with Mary and Joseph. Mary and Joseph, they have a son, and the Bible says that they called him Jesus. Now remember, names mean something. There's something about names. There's something in a name. And that's why I want to preach what's in a name, because I don't ever want us to get comfortable and relaxed around the name of Jesus that we forget, or we become so comfortable that we don't really understand what we have when we got the name of Jesus. When we got that name, folks, we got something. And I want to talk to us a little bit about that name, Jesus. The Bible tells us that is his name, Jesus, means Jehovah saves, or Jehovah has become salvation. That's what Jesus, his name, means. It means he is salvation, or that Jehovah has become salvation. You know, this world needs to hear more of that name. Come on, they're looking for a savior. They're looking for salvation. They're looking for a way out. And the name means Jehovah saves. And I just think that wherever we go and whatever we do, we ought to just talk about the name of Jesus. We ought to let everybody know who it is that we serve and who it is that we praise and who it is. Why? Because there's something that's in that name, the name of Jesus. And I think this world needs to know that Jesus still saves. Jesus still saves. Does it matter who they are? Does it matter how far they've gone? You may be sitting here today and you've got somebody in your family that you think they are so far gone. Let me just tell you that the name of Jesus means Jehovah saves, meaning that there is nobody that's without his reach that he cannot pull in. Woo, hallelujah. Jesus still saves. When we say Jesus, it's not just a historical name, When we say Jesus, it's not just a name of a brilliant rabbi. When we say the name of Jesus, it's not just a man that brought some good teaching. No, when we say the name of Jesus, we understand there's something in that name that's different than any other name you'll ever come in contact with. The name of Jesus is a saving name. Would you say hallelujah? Acts chapter 4 and 12 tells us, neither is there salvation in any other name. I want us to hear this tonight. I know we're Pentecostal and we know this, but I want us to get this. Neither is there salvation in any other name, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Why? Because there's only one name that has in it the ability to save us. There's only one name that has in it the ability to take away the sin of the world. I thank God for your name. I thank God for my name. But there's only one name. Woo, there's only one name that can save a man from his sins. The name is not Muhammad, can't do anything for you. The name is not Allah, can't do anything for you. The name is not Confucius, can't do anything for you. But I want to remind us in this house that the name of Jesus is a saving name. Woo, hallelujah. How many of you remember that day when you came in contact with that name? You know, they used to call us Jesus only. Woo, hallelujah. They used to call us Jesus fanatics. You know why? Because we love the name of Jesus. There's something about that name of Jesus. Talking about what's in a name. The name of Jesus is a saving name. I don't want you to ever give up on your lost loved ones, because Jesus still saves. Some of you are ready to put down your prayers because you think it's beyond God. I'm going to tell you right now, don't you stop praying. Don't you stop getting in that closet and praying for them, because God is about to break forth. I feel this in the Holy Ghost tonight, to let somebody be encouraged in the Lord. Keep praying. Come on, keep praying for them. Hallelujah. God's getting ready to bring us some backsliders back in the house. But we got to remember that the name of Jesus is Jehovah, has become salvation. Don't stop praying. Don't stop believing, because it's in the name. Somebody say hallelujah. But I want us to know that it's not just salvation that is in his name. Most of us tonight, we understand that salvation is in the name of Jesus. We understand that there's no name under heaven given to men whereby we must be saved. We got that. How many of you remember the day when you went down in that water in the name of Jesus? Oh, come on, somebody. If you went down in any other name, you just got wet. You got to go down in the name of Jesus. And while that is powerful, and while we all understand that Jesus is salvation, but you see, when you know what's in a name, it will change how you pray. When you really understand what's in the name of Jesus, it'll change how you approach him. When you fully understand what it is when I declare Jesus. See, some of us, we say Jesus, but I wonder, do we really know what we got? When we speak Jesus over our families and over our children, do we really understand what we're saying? And when we do, it'll change the way that we're praying. To better understand the name of Jesus, I got a lot of scriptures here, just hold with me. To better understand the name of Jesus, we need to establish something before we move on. To understand his name better. Because what I want us to do is I want us to leave tonight understanding that when we go through any circumstance and any chaotic moment, that when we utter the name of Jesus, we have a full understanding of what's behind that word and that name. It'll allow you to walk into places bold of the Holy Ghost when you fully understand it. But to understand the name of Jesus, we need to establish the fact that Jesus is the Jehovah of the Old Testament. It's important. Now, some of you are thinking, what does that matter? Let's get into this. Because if we're going to understand the importance of that name and what you have behind you, when you say, I'm a Jesus follower, you got to know what's behind that. And for us to understand that, we got to understand the fact that Jesus is the Jehovah of the Old Testament. Would you turn to somebody and say, He is Jehovah? Yeah, see, if you don't understand that, if you don't realize that He is the God of the Old Testament, we're not talking about some junior God. We're not talking about some second person. We're talking about the God of the Old Testament robed Himself in flesh and became man. And when you understand that, it'll help you understand that when I declare Jesus over my family, I know what's coming. I want us to look at this because when we establish that, His name truly begins to unfold to us when we get this. He's more than just has become salvation. He's more than that. Because here's the truth. How many of us, I'd say if not all of us, have been baptized in this house? We have. And if not all of us, I'd say pretty much most of us have been filled with the Holy Ghost. So we know that Jesus has become salvation. But we got to understand he's got more layers than that. That name has more power than just salvation. Because how many of you know that even after you're saved, you still face hell? Got like three of you. Hallelujah. How many know that you didn't get the Holy Ghost and baptized and all of a sudden everything just got put together? How many know that? And so if you know that, then you got to understand who this Jesus is and what that name is and what's in a name and more particularly what's in His name. Let's look at this. Isaiah 44 and 24. Can y'all handle some scripture? All right. Isaiah 44 and 24. Thus said the Lord, thy Redeemer, He that formed thee from the womb, I am the Lord that maketh all things. Would you say all things? He said, I am the Lord that maketh all things, that stretcheth forth the heavens alone, that spreadeth abroad the earth by myself. What God is saying, He said, I did it by myself. You know who that's talking about? That's talking about Jehovah. That's Jehovah in your Old Testament there. But now let's go to Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. Colossians 1 and 16 declares this to us. For by Him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether by thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by Him and for Him. Who's that talking about? That's talking about Jesus. That's Jesus there. Now let's go to Isaiah 43 and 14. Are you still with me? Isaiah 43 and 14 declares to us, thus saith the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, for your sake I have sent to Babylon and have brought down all their nobles and the Chaldeans who cry is in the ships. That's Jehovah. That's the God of the Old Testament declaring that I am the Redeemer. But let's look at Revelation chapter 5 and verse 9. Revelation chapter 5 and 9 tells us, and they sung a new song. Ooh, anybody got a new song in you? Ooh, if you don't, get one. Hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor and say, get a new song. And they sang a new song saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain, watch it, and hast redeemed us to God by the blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. That's Jesus there. Are you seeing the connection here? That's Jesus. There are many, many more connectors between Jehovah and Jesus, but I think that's enough to make the point across to us today that when we declare Jesus is God, that when we speak the name of Jesus, we are in fact reaching back in the Old Testament and we're bringing all of those things about Jehovah right in the middle of declaring Jesus. Ooh, hallelujah. You see, when you know that He is Jehovah, somebody say, I got it. When you know that He is Jehovah, you get to understand what's in a name and what's in His name. When you make the connection between Jesus and Jehovah, when you connect those two, it opens up your eyes and broadens your faith to understand who it is that we serve. I know you know it, but I'm going to say it. We serve a mighty, 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 mighty God. Woo, hallelujah. And so it is that we see that He is Jehovah, Jehovah. And it is that the Old Testament has seven compound names of Jehovah. And this is why I led us up here. Because when we go through these seven compound names of Jehovah, I want you to know that what we're saying is Jesus. When we declare these compound names of Jehovah, we're declaring that all of that is in him. Ooh, hallelujah. And so it is in the Old Testament that there are seven compound names of Jehovah that up until Jesus comes on the scene, that's what they knew. That's how they described him, this God that they prayed to in the Old Testament. And this Jehovah is Jesus. And so what did they say about Jehovah? Well, let's look at these in Genesis chapter 22 and 14. What did they talk about when they talked about Jehovah that will help us today? Genesis 22 and 14 says, "And Abraham called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh." Would you say Jehovah Jireh? Jehovah Jireh, as it is said to this day, "In the mount of the Lord it shall be seen." He said he is called Jehovah Jireh. Jehovah Jireh simply means the Lord will provide. Woo, hallelujah. The Lord will provide. The literal translation, I like it better. The literal translation says it like this. It literally means the Lord who sees. Woo, come on somebody, you need to let the devil know God's watching. Oh, come on, turn to your neighbor and say, God's watching. You know what Jehovah Jireh means? It doesn't just mean he'll provide. It means he's the God who sees. The Lord who sees. The Lord who will see to it. Anybody got something in your life that you're wondering where God is? I just want to remind you that when you speak the name of Jesus, you're declaring Jehovah Jireh, because Jesus is Jehovah, and Jehovah Jireh means the Lord will provide. Come on, I'm talking to us tonight and letting us know that when you declare Jesus over your situation, get ready, because provision is on its way. Woo. Hey, when your neighbor tells you how you're going to get through this, just say, Jesus. Jesus, how he's going to provide. Hallelujah. Exodus 15, 26 declares, "And said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and will give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon you, which I have brought upon the Egyptians." Watch this last one. "For I am the Lord that healeth thee." Ooh, did you get that? I am the Lord that healeth thee. What that word healeth thee is Jehovah Rapha. Is what it means. It's Jehovah Rapha, meaning the Lord who heals. Now, I know many of you, when you hear that, you immediately think of physical healing, sickness and disease and cancers and all of those things. And yes, God can heal those things. But I want us to understand that that healing is much more than just physical healing. This healing is of every kind. Let's talk about it. You ready? Because when we talk about Jehovah Rapha, we got to understand the context of Jehovah Rapha in this verse. Because it's here that Israel has made their way to Marah. And when they get to Marah, they're thirsty. And so they go up to the water and they begin to drink out of the water. But the water's bitter. I'm going to preach. The water's bitter. And so God tells Moses, here's what you got to do. I want you to go find that certain kind of tree right there. So Moses goes over, and they're thirsty, but the water's bitter. And Moses goes over, and he grabs the tree, and he follows what God says, and he takes the tree, and he places the tree into the bitter water. And the water that is bitter becomes sweet. And it's in the middle of this that Moses
begins to declare, and he says, let me tell you a little bit of something about who Jehovah is. He's a healer. He's the God that healeth thee. But if you go back just a few, there were no broken bones. There was no blind eye. There was no cripple. No, there was bitterness in the water, and God healed the bitterness. I come to remind us in this house tonight that I don't know what you're dealing with, and I don't know what you're facing, but I want you to know that Rapha, the healer, is in the house. Oh, but you don't know, Brother Winslow, hey, the bitter water can become sweet again. Ooh, somebody say hallelujah. Ooh, hallelujah. Those bitter waters became sweet again. Why? Because God's a healer of all sorts of things. He'll heal your blind eyes. He'll heal you of cancer. But he'll get down in that heart and do a healing in there too. Ooh, glory, hallelujah. He can get into those places and bring healing because he is Jehovah Rapha. And so when we declare Jesus over our circumstance, I want you to know that when you speak Jesus, the healer's on the scene. Glory, hallelujah. Praise God. Exodus chapter 17, verse 15 declares, and Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi. Would you say Jehovah Nissi? Jehovah Nissi. He built the altar and he declared Jehovah Nissi, which means the Lord is our banner. The Lord is our banner. You know what was taking place? Israel had just been in a battle, and Israel had just been in a fight with its enemy, and God came in and brought in victory. And so here he is saying that he is our banner. In other words, it's the banner that you would wave in a battle that demonstrated what tribe you were from, what country you were from, what nation you were from. But what he was saying is, hey, when we go into battle, we got a banner, but the banner isn't Texas, and the banner isn't America, and the banner isn't Winslow, and the banner isn't Center First. No, in the battle, our banner is the Lord. Hallelujah. That's why no matter where you're at, you ought to just let everybody know, my banner is Jesus. What you're saying is, hey, Jesus is going to fight my battles for me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Somebody say praise God for that one. This has to do with God stepping in and fighting our battles. When we get to that place and we say, God, I can't fight no more, we give them to him and he becomes our banner. How many are ready for God to fight your battles? Come on, how many are tired of fighting them? You want to give them to God. That's the best thing you can ever do, is to say, God has become my banner. That's why when the enemy points at you and says you're going to be defeated, why don't you just raise that banner and say, have you taken a look at the name on that banner yet? Come on, I got Jesus on my side. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. Look to somebody and say hallelujah. Praise God. Psalms 23 and 1 declares, the Lord is my shepherd. How many remember that? The Lord is my shepherd. Oh, that's famous, isn't it? Psalms 23, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. But that word there, shepherd, the Lord is my shepherd, is Jehovah Rohi. It's Jehovah Rohi, which means the Lord is my shepherd, which means he's the God who takes care of me. He's the God that watches out for me. He's the God that puts his arm around me. He's the God that watches out for the wolves that come in. He's the God that says, hey, I got you. Don't you worry. I'm with you. I'm behind you. Somebody needs to hear this tonight, because the enemies lie to you and tell you you're going to be destroyed and you're defeated and this is it and it's over. You need to remember, when you declare the name of Jesus, you need to understand what's in that name. Hallelujah. When I declare the name of Jesus, I got a shepherd who cares for me. I got a shepherd who's with me. Somebody say hallelujah. Judges 6 and 24 says, then Gibeon built an altar there unto the Lord. Let me just pause here. It's not in my message, but I just feel it right now. Hallelujah. I think what we need to do is build more altars. Hallelujah. I think what we need to have in our life are more altars. Come on, I think it's good for us to declare these names of Jesus and what they represent, but I think it's got to begin that we got to build some altars in our life. When was the last time you got in the altar of your life? Come on, when was the last time you got alone with God and got in an altar and declared some things at an altar? Hallelujah. Let me just tell you what an altar is. An altar is where something goes to die. Not in my notes, but here we are. An altar is a place we go and something dies. You got to put something on an altar. You got to kill something on an altar. And I just think there's some things in all of us that we got to get in the altar and let it die. Ooh, somebody say hallelujah. Judges 6 and 24, then Gibeon built an altar there unto the Lord and called it Jehovah Shalom. Jehovah Shalom. Unto this day it is yet in Ophrah of the Abiezrites. He said, I'm going to get to this altar and I'm going to call it Jehovah Shalom. Jehovah Shalom means the Lord is peace. Not that the Lord will be our peace. Not like the other ones. It's not the Lord is going to be our protector. No, this one is the Lord is peace. Just simple, he is peace. In other words, that when you're going through things in your life and we get alone with God and we begin to say, God, I don't know how to get through this. And my mind has so much worries and stress and so many things going on. You know what you ought to do? Just begin to say Jesus. Just begin to declare Jesus. Just begin to speak Jesus over your circumstance. Jesus over your situation. What will happen? I'll tell you what will happen. That peace of God will come in. That peace of God will flood your mind. That peace of God will take over where all the stress and anxiety is. Woo, hallelujah. Come on, y'all just looking at me now. Somebody say hallelujah tonight. And so it is, he said that the Lord is peace. Jehovah Shalom. Jehovah Shalom. That word peace there is not just a peace that comes after a great battle. We think that, oh, if I could just get some peace of mind. Anybody ever said that before? Oh, if I could just have some peace of mind. Mostly parents, hallelujah. Peace of mind. We think of peace as being something that comes after a battle, after a storm. That's not what peace is. That word peace is not something God gives you after a battle. That word peace means completeness and wholeness is what it means. When he said that he is peace, it's not like the storm is quieted. Now we're good. No, no, no. What it means is that no matter what you're dealing with, when the peace of God comes, he says, I'm going to make you complete and I'm going to make you whole. That's what it means by peace. How many of us are in this place that we could use some of that completeness and wholeness? That the enemy's going to beat you upside the head, but when God says, my peace is coming in, what he's declaring is, I'm going to make you whole and I'm going to make you complete. I got news for us tonight. There's some wholeness and some completeness that God's getting ready to do. Turn to somebody and say shalom. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We have anxieties over everything. I mean, you look around. I mean, my goodness, look around. I mean, we have more conversations around mental health and anxieties and stress and worries than we've ever heard in the history of our lives, haven't we? You know why? Because people don't have any peace. There's no peace to be found in our society, in our world, because the reason is because you can only find peace where? In Jesus. In Jesus. People are battling so much, but let me tell you, Jesus wants to give you peace. Jeremiah 23 and 6 says, in his days, Judah shall be saved, and Israel shall dwell safely. And this is his name whereby he shall be called. He said, the Lord our righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. That is Jehovah. Sitkanu is what righteousness is. He said he shall be called Jehovah Sitkanu, meaning the Lord our righteousness. I'm going to tell you, there is no righteousness in any of us by ourselves. There is no righteousness that can be found within our own abilities. No, righteousness comes when we get close to God and we connect to God and we got that name upon us that he says, hey, there's no righteousness in you, but I've got that righteousness. And if you'll take my name upon you, I'll impute that righteousness upon you. What does that mean? That just simply means salvation, which ties us back into Jesus has become our salvation. Would you stand to your feet? You say, Brother Winslow, what are you saying to us tonight? What I'm saying is if you understand what's in that name, it'll change how the battle goes. Can I get an amen? When you understand that it's not just, you know, when people say you guys are just Jesus fanatics, they're often talking about the fact that we baptize in the name of Jesus. But listen to me, there's so much that is gathered in that name, that when Jesus declared, when his mom and dad declared, he shall be called Jesus, it wasn't merely because he would come and die on a cross and shed his blood and there'd be forgiveness of sin. However, if that's the only thing you experience in that name, that's pretty powerful, isn't it? But you know what Jesus was declaring? Hey, I got you. I'm a God that's more than just a ticket to heaven. Because how many of you know if God should tarry, and I pray he doesn't, but if God should tarry 20, 30, 40 more years, how many of you know you're going to need more than just knowing I was baptized in Jesus' name? We're going to need to know, do we have a God that provides? When you get the phone call and it's not to where you thought it would go, you're going to need to know that when you say, Jesus, I need you, you're going to need to know that he's a God that will provide. You need to know those things. When you're dealing with things in your life, sickness and disease and broken heart and a wounded spirit, whatever it may be, you need to know that when you lift your hands and you declare, Jesus, I need you. You need to know that Jesus will come in and be a healer. You need to know that. When I know what's in a name, when I know what's in his name, it changes how I pray. Because now when I walk into that place of prayer, I understand that when I say, Jesus, how many ever been in prayer and you didn't know what else to pray but Jesus? You just said, Jesus. When you pray that name, you got something behind it that can make a difference. Hallelujah. I'd like for us if we would step out and come stand around the front, if you would please. I really believe that God is about to step into somebody's life tonight. I believe somebody has been warring, going through things, and tonight when you leave this place, you're going to know that every time I declare the name of Jesus over my children, now I fully understand what's behind that name. There's something weighty to the name of Jesus, folks. It's not just Jesus. There's something heavy when you speak the name of Jesus. When somebody says, oh, you one of those Jesus people, you ought to pick your head up and declare, yes, I am. Not just because he died for my sins, not just because he shed his blood, but because he's so much more than that to me. And the enemy knows what's in that name. He knows. In fact, we see this in Acts chapter 4, verse 18. The disciples had went everywhere and they preached that name of Jesus. And they declared unto him, I want you to stop preaching in that name. They didn't say, I want you to stop doing miracles. And he didn't say, I want you to stop being kind and feeding the poor. They didn't say that. It was that name that bothered them. It was the name. It wasn't like, hey, you stop singing, or you stop laughing, or you stop gathering together. No, no, no. He said, the thing that I want you to stop doing is I want you to stop preaching in that name. You can preach about anything you want to, but you got to stop preaching that name. Does that sound familiar to us today? Hey, they don't mind if you come in here and do some 10-step help program of how to get happy. Just don't say the name of Jesus. Well, I don't got no witness. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. They don't care what you do. They just don't speak the name of Jesus. Hey, they're even okay if you pray God. Just say God, right? But if you start praying Jesus, watch what happens. Can I get a witness? Just let the speaker of the house If he would have got up there and said, God is good, God is great. But when they start talking about Jesus, when they start talking about Jesus, when they start praying in Jesus' name, when we hear the name of Jesus, it bothers people because they understand what's behind the name of Jesus. Ooh, have you ever walked in some place and all of a sudden you can feel that what's in there don't like you there? Ooh, come on, somebody. It ain't you. Turn to somebody and say, it ain't you. Because you're just flesh. You know what it is? It's that name. It's the name. And they declared you can do whatever you want to do, but you got to stop preaching in the name of Jesus. Why? Because that name of Jesus was changing things. That name of Jesus was opening blind eyes. That name of Jesus was tearing the fabric of their religious system. And the spirit of this day and age is still the same, that when we declare the name of Jesus, it begins to do something to that religious spirit out there. It begins to, hey, I tell you, keep saying the name of Jesus. Keep declaring the name of Jesus. Keep declaring it. I was in a place working, and they looked at me, they knew I was a preacher, and they said, we want you to pray. And I looked back at one of the supervisors and I said, are you sure? Now, I wasn't going to jump on no tables, but I sure wasn't going to give him one of them lay me down to sleeps either, because there's something about the name of Jesus. And I looked at him, I said, are you sure? He said, yeah, I want you to pray. I said, all right. So I began to pray in this company. I began to pray, and I began to talk, and I started out with God, because you got to ease in with them. Warm them up for when you take the hook shot. Hallelujah. So I said, oh, God in heaven. It could have been any God right at that point, right? Oh, God in heaven. I began to pray, and I began to talk about God. And then I began to talk about God touching us and helping us in our company and helping us with this. And then as I began to feel myself winding it down, I could feel that name getting ready to come out. And I knew some of the people we worked for. Now the company I worked for, they were God-fearing. They were. But I knew some of the people I worked with, they weren't. So I was getting ready, because what's a prayer without the name of Jesus? Come on, somebody. What's a prayer without that name? Hey, I thank God for everybody that you can knock them if you want to. But hey, if a sports guy wants to give God praise, hey, hallelujah. But what is it if you don't say the name? It's the name. So I began to wrap it up, and I could feel it coming. There was a great war within me. And I closed it out, and I said, and I pray this all in the name of Jesus Christ. When I got done praying, I had a few people come up and said, woo, I like that. Had a few didn't. That's all right. You can't win them all. Hallelujah. But there's something about the name. Why? Because if we're going to pray, let's pray the name. If we're going to lay hands on somebody, let's do it in the name of Jesus. If we're going to walk into our homes where there's troubles and issues, then walk in there in the name of Jesus. Come on, if you're going to pray, hey, if somebody wants you to pray for them in Walmart, my God, pray for them in the name of Jesus. Pray for them in the name of Jesus. Because there's something about the name. Why do they not want them to preach in that name? Because they understood what was behind that name. Here's what I'm saying. We're going to close. Here's what I'm saying. Whatever it is in your life, I want you to begin to speak the name of Jesus over it. I know some of you are like, but I want something deeper and more profound to pray. Hey, there's nothing more deeper and profound than saying the name of Jesus, folks. There's nothing more profound than that. Hallelujah. That's why when you're almost in a wreck, what do you yell out? Not Jim Bob. Unless he was the one driving. Hallelujah. What do you yell out? You know, Jesus, right? Because there's something in that name. Hallelujah. When I get in that place, when I don't know what else to say, I just begin to call upon the name of Jesus, because I understand now there's some benefits and there's some things that come with that name. And so when I'm at Walmart and someone says, hey, are you the pastor of that church? And I say, yes. And they say, will you pray over me? And I've done it. I pray for so many people in this Walmart right there. I pray. Years ago, I prayed. I was in an airport. Are y'all still with me? Hallelujah. I was in an airport and talking to this couple on the tram going to the airport, and they were asking me, you know, what kind of work do you do? And I said, I'm a preacher. And they said, oh, really? So they began to talk to me about that. And I began to share with this woman and this lady that lived in Los Angeles. And so we talked a little bit, and then we lost track of each other. And I'm in the airport now, and I see the couple standing over there. And the guy comes over and says, will you pray for my wife? Will you pray for her before we leave? Folks, we're not in the church house. We're in the middle of a busy airport in Los Angeles. And I said, I sure will. Now, I'm going to be real honest. Can I be honest with you? You won't hold it against me? My flesh said, give them one of those, holy God. Come on, somebody. Cut me some slack. Hallelujah. My flesh said, oh, you better not act apostolic up in here. I wanted to give them the hallelujah, praise God, go in peace with the Lord. But the Lord said, you better do what I tell you to do, because you're never going to see them again. And I said, I sure will pray. So, Sister Winslow, do you remember that? Where's she at? You remember that? I mean, that's been a long time ago, hadn't it? And so right there, man, I grab a hold of her. And I don't know what happened to him, but he started fading off on me. I don't know if he started going, oh, I think I got the wrong preacher. Because I grabbed her hand. You remember that? I grabbed her hand, and I started praying, man. Oh, my God, I started praying for her. And as I'm praying, because how many of you know you can pray with your eyes open? Some of y'all just got revelation. Some of y'all like, you can pray with your eyes open. You can pray with your eyes open. So I pray, and I'm praying with her. My God, I'm just praying, and whatever God gives me, I'm speaking to this lady, and I'm praying. And I notice he's gone. He like, I'm just trying to figure out where he went. And I'm telling you, I'm praying, I'm my God. And while I'm praying, because preachers can preach and think at the same time. And I'm praying for it. I'm my God, and I'm Jesus, and I'm speaking the name of Jesus right there in the middle. Folks are walking by. And I'm just giving it to her. And I look over and I find him. He's trying to check in his bags. And I've just got her and I'm praying for her. And I look over because I'm thinking, man, is he going to punch me or what's going on with this guy? He looks over and he gives me this. Gave me this. Apparently he says she needs it. But can I tell you what I was doing? It wasn't Brother Winslow. It wasn't nothing I could do. But in that moment, there was a moment where I had to pray. And I knew that the thing I had to pray was Jesus, because I didn't know what she was going through. I didn't know what they were. Obviously, there was something going on, because tears were coming down her face right there in LAX. And her husband's giving me the thumbs up like, give it to her, buddy. Give it to her. But something was happening, and I'm going to tell you, it wasn't Brother Winslow, nothing in me. But I'll tell you what it was the name of Jesus. I don't know for sure, but I would just surmise that she had never had the name of Jesus prayed over her in her life. And when we begin to say in Jesus' name, Jesus, you can protect. Jesus, go with her wherever she goes. I just believe that Jehovah came in, and that name of Jesus began to move and do something. What would happen in this church? What would happen in your life if you caught on to the power of the name of Jesus? And you started going into your workplace, and you started going into places of your home. And when people want you to pray, you just said, I got nothing to lose. Somebody just needs to just get to a point where you say, I got nothing to lose. I'm just going to start praying how God tells me to pray. You'd be surprised what will happen when you speak Jesus over somebody. Hallelujah. Why don't we do that right now? Why don't you raise your hands right where you are? And we're going to sing in just a moment. Thank you, praise team, for being so patient. We're going to pray over us, and we're going to